evening. The holidays are over. We're back to schedule. And we started a new cycle of the reading of the Torah. We have 52 weeks a year, and every week we read one or two chapters of the Torah. We started Parashat Bereshit now, last Shabbat, 2 days ago, the creation of the world. Chazal, our sages, are suggesting that a person should not dig too deep into the creation of the world because it's not something very simple to understand. It's the most complicated thing for a person to understand how something like this was created. We have it in a chapter what we call Bereshit, Genesis, in the beginning of the first book of the five books of Moses. We have it in 10 pages or 12 pages, and that's basically the description. The actual creation of the world is described in 2-3 pages. That's really it. You know, it's one chapter in the Torah. So billions or perhaps trillions of transactions were made in those 6 days of creation before Shabbat came, first Shabbat. We cannot even understand how many things got together, or the physics, someone who knows biology, physics, the law of nature, so many things, galaxies, astronomy, so many things are involved in the creation of the world. And everyone complete the other. Obviously, to describe the creation of the world, you need billions of books, not 3 or 4 pages. Every normal human being understands that it's very, very brief. We just have a brief of a brief of how it was. Many people read the first chapter of the Torah, and they come with thousands of questions. How can it be? How it was? We don't understand. Doesn't make sense. They don't understand that you don't even have 1% of 1% of 1% forever like this and of the creation of the world. And you come and try to already make an investigation. How can it be? How it was? It's very ridiculous. People sometimes, they shoot, but they don't think what they say. You don't expect now, based on such a brief explanation how the world was created, to come and understand every detail. And between you and I, let's say, hypothetically speaking, that the creator of the world will be more than generous and try to describe to us how everything really was formed and created and connected and complete each other and all the secrets of nature. Millions of them were discovered thousands of years later. Everything will come in one book. You know, one person would have the patience to read it from the beginning to the end. They need to live a billion years to finish the book. It's not even realistic. You hear 70, 80 years. Just trying to understand the creation of this amazing world will take you forever and ever. So what's the first suggestion? Don't dig too much. Anyway, it's very hard to understand. Some people digging into the story of the creation of the world, instead of becoming great believers of God, they became a big atheist. I give you an example. Many of the genius people who think they know too much, they have this famous question. Well, based on the story of the creation, there was light in the first day. Hashem separated between the light and the darkness. He called it the light day and the darkness night. This is the first day of the creation. But only on the fourth day, it described how the stars and the moon and the sun was hung in space. So how can it be? It looks like a major contradiction. All these genius people who ask this question, first of all, they're far away from being genius. Why? Even if they come and try to use it to claim that a person wrote the Torah, do you know what a foolish person that we write a book that talking about day and night, light, and then right after that only 4 days later the sun was made? Every fool, every idiot would know not to make such a mistake. You don't need to be a god or anything like that. Before you attack, you have to use your common sense. Obviously, there's something here you don't understand. So that's why I always say the answer to all these brilliant questions is that we have the oral Torah. Without it, we cannot move an inch. We would know nothing. Even with the oral Torah, by the creation of the world, you still won't know 1%. But without it, there's no chance to understand anything, anything. So what does the oral Torah say? That the first day is speaking about a spiritual light, not a physical light. Spiritual light that, you know, you're able to see through this light, like we have today X-rays. It penetrates through item, through material. This was a special light, a spiritual light, that on the fourth day was replaced with a physical light. And even the physical light that was created supposedly on the fourth day, when the sun was hung and started to give heat and light to the world, even the sun doesn't give 100% physical light. If you remember, I had a whole lecture about the light of the sun. We spoke about the light. That's the name of the lecture. And I asked a question. And this is a question that basically doesn't have a clear answer. What's the question? It says that the speed of light is 276,000 kilometers a second. 300,000 kilometers a second. 300,000 kilometers per second. Do you know what it means? It's like you go, the entire state of New York is not 300,000 kilometers. From one top to the bottom. And that means the speed of light travels bigger than the entire state of New York or the entire country of Israel in less than a second. If you release the light from the top of Israel to go all the way to the bottom of Israel, it's only 700 kilometers. So it basically goes around the world a few times. The speed of light, it won't be still a second. Very, very fast, the speed of light. The noise doesn't travel in the same speed like the light. Many times we hear thunders, we see lightning. Lightning and thunders comes in different timing. But everyone who knows a little bit about physics knows that the lightning and the thunder was released in the same exact second. No difference. It's one as results of the other. Once this energy is released, it creates a bomb, an explosion, and at the same time it sends lightning. The only thing is that the speed of light is so much faster that it travels to Earth in tenth of a second or hundredth of a second, and the noise is traveling slower. So by the time it will get to us, it will take 2 minutes later until it will get to us, or a minute later, or half a minute later. You understand? But sometimes the explosion is right above us. And it's very close to us. That's why the lightning and the thunder sometimes are a matter of 2-3 seconds. That shows that it just hit our neighborhood or our town. But if you first see the light and then only a minute later you hear the thunder, that means it's far away. It's not so dangerous. So, but they technically it's the same thing. But they travel in a different speed. So I once asked a question. The light has a special speed. Everything that has a speed has to be materialistic. If it's not materialistic, it's not material, how can you measure its speed? Material moves from point A to point B in a certain speed. How do you measure light if it's not something physical? If it was something spiritual, you cannot measure it. Something physical, you can measure. However, we have a contradiction here. What's the contradiction? If you send light into a surface of some material, like a wall or a screen, first of all, we see that the darker the surface is, it would stop the speed of light more. For instance, if you send the light in 300,000 kilometers a second and it hit a wall, if the wall is white, the light would penetrate the wall and come from the other side faster and stronger than if the wall is dark, like black. So the darker it is, it stops the light more. That's something very interesting. Plus, now comes the biggest miracle perhaps in the whole creation. What's the biggest miracle? When a person take a ball, you throw the ball, we can measure the speed of the traveling of the ball from point A to point B. When a car is driving, You look at the speedometer, you know how fast you drive. Everything is a combination of way and speed. It's all our life. Every step of our life, it's depend on time. The word Bereshit bara Elokim, in the beginning, all the commentators explain, what does it mean Bereshit? If there was no material, where is the beginning point? Time only exists where material exists. If there's no material, there's no time. So when there was no world, there was nothing physical yet before God decided to create this world. You could not say in the beginning or in the end, because there's nothing to measure what's beginning, what's end. So what's the answer to it? In the beginning means the moment, that billionth of a second that God created material, that's from that moment, that means the creation of time. Once material was created, at that billionth of a second that the entire massa, the entire material of this world was created, that's when the time started to be measured. It cannot be a second later, it cannot be a second earlier. That's called the beginning of time. Albert Einstein, which was a brilliant person, he receives a lot of credit in the world for some of the things he discovered. But everyone who knows a little bit Torah knows that everything Albert Einstein discovered, the Ramban, which was not a scientist, he lived 700 years before Albert Einstein, he wrote it clearly in his books, in his writings. Albert Einstein got a lot of credit by proving that time exists only where material exists, among the other things he proved. But the Ramban wrote about it 700 years before him. Just the world doesn't know about the Ramban. The media that we had in the time of Albert Einstein did not exist 750 or 800 years ago. He got the credit. The Ramban already wrote about it as a, by the way, piece of information. Nobody treated it as a brilliant, amazing discovery. Why? In Judaism, it's rule number one. The first rule in the Torah is the discovery of Albert Einstein. Bereshit, the creation of time. But sometimes you get so much noise about something, it's simple, it's in the Torah. Like the discovery of America. How much noise Columbus discovered America? In the Zohar, 2,000 years ago, they speak about seven continents. They speak about it. So that the Zohar knew there's an extra continent. Columbus got a lot of credit, but it was already in a Kabbalah. Telescope, Hubble, Galileo Galilei, they got so much credit for the telescope that Hubble started and Galileo finished. The Gemara says Rabban Gamliel had a telescope. He used to look at people, 2,000 amah on the land, 2,000 amah in the ocean. 2,000 amah is 1 kilometer, one in a, on the land, one in a, on the water, it's 2 kilometers. It's 1.6 miles, 40 blocks in Manhattan, which means he was able to see people from a distance of 40 blocks in Manhattan. So if you stand by the Queensboro Bridge on 60th Street, you are able to see people in Harlem by 100th Street with a tube that he had. When? 2,100 years ago. Nobody learns about this in college, and I can give thousands of examples, but that's not the topic. So the question about light, the speed of light, once it hit the wall, if you throw a ball, right? If I throw a ball and someone was trying to block my ball, once my ball hit his hand, if the ball was traveling 100 miles per hour, once he hit his hand and he continued to travel after, let's say he pushed his hand back and the ball continued, it won't go 100 miles an hour. It will go to 10 miles an hour. The ball, after 10 feet later, it will fall on the floor and won't move anymore. Why? Because that person was able to block most of the energy. In order for you to make the ball continue in its traveling, you need new source of energy. Without energy, the ball won't move. Every material who is on a movement needs a source of energy. Gasoline, burning of gasoline, someone pushing, few people pushing, etc. Pressure. This is all sources of energy. The light travels out of nowhere. Nobody understands the source of energy of the light. Not only that, when the light hit the wall stopped the light penetrates from the wall, and after it goes from the other side, it accelerates by itself again to 300,000 kilometers per second. How? Nobody knows. There's no source of energy. No scientist knows the answer to this question. And not only that, it accelerates out of nowhere by a total miracle, and it happened trillions of times a second in the world, everywhere you go. Not only that, it always like that, it won't accelerate for more or less than 300,000 kilometers a second. It will always come to that moment, not a drop more, not a drop less. And there are people in this world that still have the nerve to say that the world was created by a random explosion. A rule like this can be created by itself. It contradicts all the law of physics. The law of physics shows that you need an energy to move an object. Without an energy, it will never move. Even a wind is sorts of energy. It pushes something. Over here, out of nowhere, it accelerates. So this is this light that was created on the fourth day. It's not a totally physical thing. So I asked once, what's the light of the sun? Is it something physical or it's something spiritual? The answer is, it's both. It's physical in one way because it had speed that can be detected, can be measured. So that's something physical. That's the only thing that is on a movement, it's physical. And the other way is that it behaves in a spiritual way. So the sun that replaced that 100% spiritual light that Hashem created in the beginning of the creation, it was replaced from 100% spiritual to something like it's 50-50. What happened to that light, the first light? That light, the oral Torah teaching us that God saw that this light is such a great spiritual thing. We have no understanding. What does it mean? So he hid it. It's called in Hebrew, Aor HaGanuz. Some yeshivot in Israel call the Aor HaGanuz, the hidden light. Based on that term in the oral Torah, Aor HaGanuz. Ganuz means gniza. When we have something that the name of Hashem is on it, we have to put it in a gniza. Gniza means hidden. You bury it in the ground or you do all kinds of things with that. Ganuz means hidden. Hashem put that light to the righteous people for the future to come. This light will return to the creation. When the worthy people will return back to the world, after the resurrection of the death of all the righteous people, that light will return to the tzaddikim. But Hashem did not want the wicked people to enjoy this 100% spiritual light. I guess it was such pleasure to have this light. Adam, before he sinned, was able to enjoy that light. After he sinned, Hashem took away that light and replaced it with the sun. There's a midrash, the sun and the moon was created in the beginning in the same size. But the sun, the moon, complained that how come there are two kings in one system? One place cannot have two bosses. Either this is the boss or this is the boss. There's no business that two bosses can run the place. There's two opinions, two different opinions. Always going to be arguments. Same thing in the army. Can have two chief commanders. It's either he's the boss or he's the boss. Everywhere else, you cannot have two bosses. He's the top boss or he's the one. That's it. So, you know, we have stars. By the way, you know, one of the common mistake is we think that the sun is the biggest star and the moon looks so big compared to the dots of the stars. It's not, we all know today that some of these dots that we see are much, much bigger than our world by 100 times. Just very, very far away. Another common question is people say, you, the religious people, claim that the world is only 5,770 something years ago. Less than 6,000 years old. But scientists, everywhere you go, they claim the world is millions of years old, billions of years old, trillions of years old, everyone with these theories. So some stars are hundreds of years of light so far away that if the world is only 6,000 years old, how the light arrived from that star to Earth? It will take much more than 6,000 years to see this light. So here is a proof that the fact that we see the light of some of these stars that are so far away, that shows you that the world is much older than 5,800 years, right? That's a legitimate claim. Not at all. When God created the world was ready, wasn't developing after the moment of the creation. Once the sixth day of creation was ended, the world was perfectly ready. All the raw materials, gold, silver, rocks, sand, water, everything was ready, oxygen. You didn't need to improve the world anymore. It's true that every raw material in a creation, the Torah say, was not made square. You don't have anything square that was made. We, as individual, we take wood and we make it into square. We take rocks, we make it into square. We can play with the raw material. We take a diamond, look like a stone in the street, we turn it into $10 million, shiny, beautiful, symmetric diamond. This is a part of our creation. But the world didn't need our improvement. We cannot add to God's world anything. We can use the world for our benefits as we choose. The world was ready. Therefore, since the galaxies are all into place and they're all in a movement and they all have speed, the whole system is moving. And in the system, there's billions of movements. And everyone has its track and no one collides with the other. Just when the world was created, the light that they sent was already sent. It was built with the line of light. Other worlds, there was no point of creating them because we would never see them. And in the Torah, there is a verse in the Tanakh, "Su marom enechem uru mi bara ele." Lift up your head to the sky and see. God wanted us to be impressed from his creation, to show us, to remind us that this almighty, this unbelievable creator cared about each one of us, and he chose us, the Jewish nation, to be his children. The more we are amazed from him and his size and his abilities and his brilliance and his talents, etc., the more we are impressed from him, the more lucky we feel that he chose us to be his soldiers and his messengers, right? If your boss worth $1 million or if your boss worth $1 billion, there's a difference with the way you treat him, right? If you own a little shoeshine store and you own Microsoft, there's a little bit difference on the respect you give him, no? Not because this guy is smarter than the other or is a better person. No, because his achievement, his power is much, much greater than the power of the shoeshine store. That's all. Very simple. Everybody understands the rules. Same thing over here. Since God wanted us to see all the stars that are very far away from us, he had to create them with light that already reached Earth in the moment of creation. Otherwise, he will reach the creation by the time the creation will end. So what's the point of creating it? Also, for all these people who try to claim that the world is millions or billions of years old, did you ever see, let's say in sport, they decide to make a basketball stadium. So how long does it take to build a stadium? Let's say 5 years. From the minute they decide to dig the hole in the ground, they come, they make the place, it's finished. Let's say 5 years it takes, or 2 years, whatever it takes. Now imagine they make a basketball court and it's ready, and only 100 years later the team come to start playing over there. What everyone would say, what a foolish mayor, what a stupid engineer, what stupid people. Why would they create a court or a stadium 100 years before there is a team? Usually first there is a team, right? There's a plan. And they need a court, they need a stadium, so you make a stadium. The moment the stadium is ready, the next day the team comes, they make a grand opening, and they begin to play. If God decided that he will create Adam in a 6 day of the creation, according to those who say, you know what, the first 5 days of the creation, perhaps each day was millions of years old, right? Only the last day of the creation was 24 hours. Adam was created and Shabbat came. But those 5 days of the creation probably took millions or billions of years. What's the point? For what? If there's no people, no one to calculate time, besides some fish or whatever, no one has common sense, no one has free choice, time is not an object. What's the point of making a world and keeping it billions of years empty? And then create Adam. What for? had to be something that happened within moments. It's all foolish claims. On top of that, I read in one science book that every year, all the rivers in the world connect to the big sea. All the rivers somehow in the world, they connect to the big sea. And there's always movement of water. And those rivers have salt. Even though not all of them you feel the salt, but almost every water has salt. But it accumulates to millions of tons of salt. For instance, based on the scientific measurements, all the rivers grab with them, once they're on their way to the big sea, 400 million tons of salt per year. Ton of salt is 2,200 pounds of salt. Pound of salt, you know, you go to the store, pound of salt, you know how it is. Imagine 2,200 boxes of salt. That's 1 ton. Multiply it by 400. So 400 times 2,200, you know, and multiply by a million. I'd say all the Costco stores and Walmarts and the supermarkets in the world won't create that amount of salt together, combined, per year. If the world was millions or billions of years old, take million years, just 1 million. They say 300 million, 200 billion, all kinds of nonsense. Take 1 million years. Multiply it by 400 million tons of salt. The oceans that we have, the big sea, should have become, a long time ago, a huge pile of salt all the way to God and come back. There won't be any water. If you have a little lake in your neighborhood, a tiny lake, like you go in Englewood, New Jersey, this Gaddafi that is already join Arafat and his friends over there in hell. He has a mansion in Englewood, and he has a little river inside his yard. See, he has his own lake. Let's take this lake and spill tons of salt into it. What would happen in the end to the lake? Nobody would know there was a lake there. It would be just a huge pile. In the beginning, the salt would absorb the water more and more and more. Eventually, it would be so much salt, there will be no water left. What happened in the end? You come and you see a huge pile of salt all the way from the ground, all the way to the stars. That's really what should have been the big sea. 400 million tons of salt every year multiplied by millions of years? It cannot be. So the world, obviously, based on the calculation, is only a few thousand years old. And I always say, this is a very foolish argument to begin with. Why? It's really not relevant to the most important question in life, to be righteous or wicked. That's it. It's really not relevant. Because everything the Torah spoke about is anyway from the birthday of Adam, Rosh Hashanah, the Jewish year. It's the birthday of Adam. Nobody cares what really was before. From Adam on, the story begins. Adam, Chava, they have children. The world starts. The whole story of the Torah starts after Adam was created. What happened before, it's really totally not relevant. When people see the NBA games today, anybody care how they created the stadium? Do you ever see a game and they talk about, you know, now it's part of the game to understand how they make the projector. It's not a part of the game. Nobody cares about it. Who cares if it was a million years old or a billion years old or 5 or 6 thousand years? It's really not a relevant argument. People are focusing on this argument nonstop. I don't think there's any other arguments that people argue about more than this. For what? It's not relevant to the obligation that we have in the Torah, to be righteous. What does it have to do? Okay, so you want to claim the world that the first 5 days of Genesis was millions of years each. How does it relevant to what the Torah say to do? It's not changing nothing. The Ari says something very interesting. The Ari HaKadosh 500 years ago, based on Kabbalah, that Hashem created the world old. What does it mean? Today when a baby is born, if you don't know how old is the baby, scientists can measure him after a few months and tell you more or less how old is this baby. Maybe they will even be precise to the day. I don't think to the hours, but to the day they can measure, you know what, this baby is. So, you know, the point here, when the argument's over here, You know, like I heard that something very interesting. You know, they have those caves. I don't know how to call it in English. They have netifim that over the years they have drop and another drop and another.
Stalactites.
Huh?
Stalactites.
Stalactites?
Stalagmites.
Stalagmites. What a word. Anyway, sometimes I wonder who invented these words in English. Like, anyway, so those, based on that, what they see, they come now and they measure how much it grows every year or every 10 years. So if they see if it grew by 1 centimeter in the last 10 years or in the last year, so they say, okay, so if this is 3 feet long, let's calculate how much. Oh, so that's a sign that it's so big. That's a sign that this cave is 10,000 years old. Or that's a sign that this cave is a million years old. Whenever they come with their calculation. So they have a very famous cave that based on that they try to prove that the world is very old. And one day in a construction site in San Francisco, they found exact same one that is 1.5 meter. And based on that, the world was supposed to be 150,000 years old based on that. And the people who made that construction site are still alive. That's a very foolish way of measurement. How do you know that what you see right now in the last 5 years was here 100 years ago the same way, the same pace? How do you know? I give you an example. A person is 6 feet tall. If you say, okay, you know what, this person is 60 years old and he's 6 feet tall, that means every 10 years he grew by a feet. Right? When he was 10 years old, he was 1 foot. Why? Because every 10 years he grew by a foot. That means when he's going to be 70, he's going to be 7 feet tall. It's nonsense. He grew when he was a baby until 18, and from then on he's the same. There's no way. Maybe a million years he's the same. He only grew for 5 years, and then for 1 million years it stayed the same. Or maybe it was going reverse. Maybe it's decreasing and going up again and going down again. So many things not changing in nature. To come and assume the age of the world based on this assumption. Okay, so let's conclude. Whenever you run into this argument, the best way to do is to say like this. There are two ways to prove, the long way or the short way. The long way will take years. The short way will take 1 minute. Why? If there are so many scientists in the world, and they all more or less went to the same famous universities, all these most famous universities in the world, take the top 10 universities in the world that contributed the best scientists that we have on record. Take all these scientists, they use the same formula, the same methods, the same professor, the same book, the same tools, the same everything. Each one of them, with his research, comes with a different result. Did you ever see two universities that had the research and all of them came to the same result? If 100 universities in the world in the last 400 years, all of them came out with the same exact age, there's something to think about. Everyone unanimously agree on the age of the world. But everyone comes with a different age. You turn on the Discovery Channel 10 million years ago when the world started to shift to the West. Then a week later, another show. 300 billion years ago, everyone has a completely different. How do you come from the same university, same professor, one say this, one say something totally different? Can 100 people come and say about Moshe that he's in a different age and all of them be right? He says 2 years old, she says 20 years old, he says 100 years old. Everyone is right? How can it be? He has only one age. He doesn't have 100 different ages. Cannot be all of them are right. So if all scientists comes with an age and everyone is different than the other, some more, some less, why should we waste a minute on them? This is what we want to dedicate our life on, a theory of so many people who wants attention and money. So what's the conclusion? The conclusion is to go into my website and watch that film, The Fingerprint of the Creation by the scientist Robert Gentry, non-Jewish scientist, who made a great work. And he shows you one research after the other, how they all totally baloney. Everything that they claim, he shows you. See, based on that, they decided the world is millions of years old. Look, I show you, 3 months old. Shows you on on a pecham, the charcoals, how do you call it? There's one way to measure it is when they have underground caves.
Coal.
So you say coal, here is a coal, that according to the research, it shows that the world is such and such, hundreds of thousands of years old. And let's show you the same piece. Can you see with a microscope? Can you see any difference? This is only 3 months old. You see these bones? They claim is a million years old. You see this bone? It's a bone of a chicken that was found. It was construction work. People threw it under the ground 3 months ago. They found it. They say it's millions of years old. Amazing. You see these things. You cannot believe how we were fooled by all these manipulators. One way or the other, I think the best way to conclude it, we don't have to win the arguments because it's an irrelevant argument. Some arguments is life and death. If we lose the argument, the whole Torah collapse, such as in my Torah and Science film, I show some things that the oral Torah said. It's divine information. Divine information cannot be any errors. You find one error, that's it. I have all these Christians trying to brainwash me, all these missionaries writing me all kinds of things from the New Testament. I already, in the beginning, I wasted my time reading their nonsense. Now I don't even waste a second. As soon as I see another one, right away I shut the email. But I answer them in one line. First answer one of my questions in a debate and we'll talk. I know they don't have one answer. I don't understand why these people continue to waste time. If you see somebody came and show 50 mistakes in your book, and they're all human errors, how do you argue? How do you continue the arguments? How? You don't see that it's not from God. If it's not from God, it doesn't matter what it says. That's all. It doesn't matter. It can say wonderful things. The teaching of JC. Who was JC? A Jew from Yeshiva. Whatever his rabbi taught him, he put. And his followers put some of Judaism in the New Testament. Why are you so impressed? Why are you giving him credit? Why you give me credit? People give me sometimes credit like I'm Rabbi Akiva or something. They listen to my lecture. Wow, what a speaker. What speaker? I read 5, 6, 7 books. This is words of Rabbi Akiva, word of Moshe Rabbeinu, word of the Rambam. Put it nicely together. Wow. Holy man. What holy man that knows to read Hebrew? Why you give the credit to the wrong person? The credit belongs to the giants, to the source. Hey, you know what JC said? Love your friend like you love yourself. Thank you very much. We didn't know it from the Torah. All kinds of things. They're so ignorant. They are impressed by things that Muhammad say. It's word by word from the Torah. Why are you giving them credit for? But that's it. Ignorance, I always say, ignorance is very dangerous. Very dangerous. You know, if you know Arabic, mamash, half of the language is Hebrew. Libi albi, nafshi nafsi. Almost all the words is an imitation of Hebrew. Today you ask an Arab something like this, he will swear in his mother that we copy from them. That's how it is. That's how, you know, that we had the We know that when the goyim goes to visit a grave, they put flowers on it. So the Jews, some Jews also do it. So the rabbis say, no, it's a goyish custom. It's a non-Jewish custom. Don't do it. Really, the truth is that it's a Jewish custom. The goyim saw the Jews go to the grave and put flowers. So they copy from the Jews. 500 years later, now the Jews cannot do it because the goyim do it. What happened if the goyim will start putting tefillin tomorrow? Will cancel mitzvah tefillin? It's a goyish custom. I promise you, there will be rabbis who say, look, the goyim in Japan, they put tefillin. It's a goyish custom. You have to do something. We have to change the tefillin.
Kneeling. Huh? Kneeling. Praying on your knees.
Praying on the knees. Many of our customs changed. Some of our customs changed because the goyim imitated us. You know, like the Arabs going to their mosque, they go without shoes. Where they got this idea? Shoes is bad. Where? From Bet HaMikdash. The Kohanim, Bet HaMikdash. They will go barefoot. Bet HaMikdash, you didn't bring shoes in. Why you don't go in with shoes? Better to go with your stinky feet? What's better? Better you get a nice, great shoes and you go inside. It's more respectable. Shoes is leather, and leather is from a dead animal. You killed an animal for that, better keep it outside of a holy place. That's just one example. So now everywhere they go to pray, they go without shoes because of that. But Jews used to take their shoes also before. When they used to go. You know, I once say a story that the Karaites are a cult that came from Judaism that they eliminated the oral Torah. So they only go by the written Torah, which is baloney anyway, because you cannot do anything without the oral Torah. The Karaites, how do they know the holidays? You wouldn't know one rule of the holiday without the oral Torah. So whatever they like, they take from the oral Torah. The rest, we don't believe in the oral Torah. So anyway, one thing is that they, a few hundred years ago, in the time of the Gaon Mivilna, 250 years ago, one Karaite came to the king. They wanted to have a debate with an Orthodox rabbi. The Vilna Gaon was a busy rabbi. He didn't want to waste time with this debate. So he sent one of his students. He said, go take care of this matter in front of the king. So they came to the king. So the king said, okay, let's hear both sides what you have to claim. So before they went into the office of the king, they saw that everyone takes their shoes off. The king takes his shoes, his advisor. Or the Karaite Jew, he took off his shoes off. The rabbi also took his shoes off, but he was holding his shoes in his hand. And he walked in front of the king in the debate. The Karaite stand like this with his nice outfit. And the Orthodox rabbi is holding his shoes in his hand. So the Karaites, he wants to instigate between the king and the Orthodox rabbi, like they always do. Nothing changed. Same tactics today. So he said to the king, you see, your majesty, what a dirty people they are. He doesn't even trust you and your people in your palace. So he brings his lousy $5 shoes into the office that maybe you, the king, or your people will steal his shoes. So the king looks at the Jew holding his shoes. He's wondering, well, why you really bought your shoes in? So he said to the rabbi, why do you have to answer? The rabbi said, no, I'm not worried about you stealing my shoes. I know he's going to steal my shoes. So the Karaite says, I need his lousy shoes. I'm going to steal his shoes? This is all baloney. So let me tell you something. 3,300 years ago, our great-great father, Moshe Rabbeinu, Moses, was walking somewhere in a mountain in a desert, and he saw a bush. The bush was burning, and a voice came from the bush. He said, Moses, take your shoes away off your feet, because the place where you're standing is holy. So Moshe took his shoes off, and he went towards the fire. He spoke to God what he spoke. When he came back, the shoes disappeared. Why? The Karaite rabbi came and stole his shoes. So the Karaite went crazy. Said to the king, you see what a liar? See what a liar? The first Karaite rabbi was only 800 years ago, rabbi, whatever his name was, Anan or something. So the king looks at the Orthodox rabbi, so he says, you see, the debate is over. He just proved that the first Karaite is only 800 years ago. We have a record of 3,300 years. This lowlife comes, invented a new cult 800 years ago. Now they come to say that we are not authentic. The king finished the debate before it started. You're only 800 years old? So what are you coming to contradict? 2,000 years of tradition before you even start. Same thing, Muslims, Christians. Well, what do you came to bring to the world? They found a very easy way out. Instead of saying that we have to repent and regret our sins and make repentance and give charity and fast on Yom Kippur and become better and improve our personality, etc., what's the best way to take a dead Jew, JC, and say he will repent for our sins? He suffer for us. Very good. Let him suffer for us. We can do whatever we want. Somebody's already making tshuva for us. What a great way. Do whatever you want. You understand? But it's against the Torah. Torah says, Ish bechet'o yumat. Everyone responsible for his own sins. No Jew can make repentance for another Jew. Not even a son of a father. Not even a father for the son. Not even a husband for the wife. Not a wife to the husband. Not the student to his rabbi, not the rabbi to the student. Every person is 100% guilty or righteous based on his own choices. And if he made a mistake, it's only in his hand to correct his mistakes. That's it. That's in the Torah. What happened to God? He drank maybe too much l'chaim, forgot it. 1,300 years later that he found JC that couldn't even help himself, now he will repent for the whole world? Ay, ay, ay. How much more time we'll waste on this? Okay, so let's go back here. So, first day, Hashem separated between the light and the darkness. Tell me now, darkness, it's a creation or it's a lack of light?
It's a lack of light. No, it's creation. That's right.
Before the world was created, what was in space?
Completely dark.
It was completely dark. But completely dark, does that mean that the darkness is something that was created also from nothing? That before the darkness was created, there was really nothing, and now darkness was created? Or because there was no light, darkness is... it's when there's no light, there's no light, it's darkness. And if there is darkness when there's no light, why the darkness is black? Why the darkness is not green? It's also a very hard question. Air, is a creation or no? Air is a creation. Why? Look at the tires of the airplanes. 500 people land in JFK. What's hold the entire play? The air in the tires, right? Air. Now, one semi-trailer got on a bridge. And he didn't read the sign. You know, they have heights for the truck. Can I go? So because of that, he didn't read. So the top of the truck got stuck in the ceiling of the underpass. Now everyone is wondering, what are we going to do? We have to break the entire bridge to get him out. There's no way in and out. Until one clever guy said, no, take the air out of the tire. What is it? About a third of a feet. I don't know, maybe half a feet. They took it down, the air, and the truck moved a little bit, and he got out. So you see, the air has a tolerance. An entire building can stand on air. Air catch place. Air, it's pressure. If you put a lot of air in a certain bowl or something, there's nothing else you can enter. If the air won't come out of the holes, there's nothing you can push. So air, it's a creation. But what about darkness? We don't know. I don't know the answer. It's a good question. It's a scientific argument. So now the Torah continues. 6 days of creation. Everything was made. Now comes the famous story of Adam and Eve and the snake. Who was this snake? Who was he?
Satan.
Who is this snake was? We have so many thousands of different snakes today in the world. Small, big, poisonous, not poison.
He used to walk like Adam.
This snake was a real animal? It was a spiritual creation? It was like an angel, like the Satan? What was he? How was he able to talk? He talked in a language that Adam and Chava understood. Now, Adam was created with certain intelligence that basically a lot of the Hebrew language that we speak to them came from him. Why he called himself Adam? Because he was taken from the Adama. Adama means earth. Adam, he was taken from the earth, so he called himself Adam because he was taken from the sand, from the earth. Adam, Adama, same word. Adam, you know, A, it's Hashem. Adam, Adama, he was taken from Adama, so it's Adam. Chava, Em Kol Chai, every one of the world. Kelev, Kulo Lev, Sus, Sas Lakrav. Every one of the animals, the name indicates what's special about this creation. Everything. So, you know, like Shamayim. What's Shamayim? What's Shamayim? Sham, Mayim. Sham means there. Mayim means water. There, water. Where is the water? In the sky. Waters are coming, clouds, it's a circle. Like the Torah say, Edi Ale Min Haaretz. The cloud will rise. The humidity creates that the water from the rivers and the oceans with the heat rising up, evaporates, and then they create clouds. If you go on a plane, you see all these clouds below you. Sometimes you fly, it's very, very cloudy and rainy day. A minute later, sunny, beautiful. As soon as you go above the, 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 the clouds, you don't see any rain. It's very, very sunny. So this is what the Torah says. The clouds come up, pressure, they explode, rain is falling, local rain, based on where the clouds are. Very, very, very good. But there's two kinds of rain. Two kinds of rain. One rain is the local rain of the area from the clouds of that area. That's most of the rains that we get. But there is another kind of rain. What's the other kind of rain? The other kind of rain, it's rains that come from different stars. That's what it says in the Torah, Iftach lecha ha'elokim et otzaro atov, right? Hashem will open you his special treasure, right? This is the water on the sky. This is what David HaMelech wrote in Tehillim 3,000 years ago, which is one of the 24 books of the Tanakh. What does it say? Ya'alelu et Hashem, amayim asher mitachat lashamayim, the water under the heaven and the water above the heaven. Everyone was wondering until 100 or 200 years ago when we didn't have satellites yet and airplanes and all, there's no way to go into space. Everyone was wondering what water David HaMelech is speaking about. Where is this water above the heaven? Above the heaven, we see dots that gives us light. Sun, moon, stars, that's all. And the rest is all space. Where is the water? Water above the heaven. Just today, or yesterday, somebody decided to break the speed of light. Speed of light is like 1,000 kilometers an hour. You know, huh? The speed of sound. I'm sorry, sound. So you know, when I was in the army, there's a rule in Israel that the F-16 pilots cannot go faster than the speed of sound. It's called 1 Mach. That's 1 Mach per hour. What is Mach? I think it's a thousand kilometer per hour, like more if you go faster than 1,050 or 1,070, something like that. So if we drive a car 100 kilometer an hour, which is 60 miles an hour, 100 kilometer multiplied by 10. If you drive 10 times faster than what you drive on a normal speed on a highway, you go faster than the speed of sound. So what happens when you go faster? You get an explosion. You hear a real explosion, like sounds like an atomic bomb. Boom, the whole area, the whole town. It breaks the glasses. In a war, the pilots do it on purpose. When they go to certain areas, they say, let's break all the glasses in the area here. So they go a little bit faster. You hear such a boom, it shakes the entire town, and all the glasses smash. But in Israel, you don't want to make damage to your own citizens. It's against the law. But sometimes it happens accidentally in a combat, you know. So you hear in the desert, you hear. So somebody decided to break the speed. They decided to jump from 39 kilometer height. You know, it's like 30 miles. I mean, 30, what is it? 30, not 30,000, 39,000 kilometer. Which is 30,000 miles. You know, when you fly in a plane, you see 15,000 mile height, minus 100 degrees. But he needed a special astronaut, Alfred. And he had a special ball that took him all the way high, and he jumped. And he made it. You know, you saw, it's everyone speaking about it. He broke the record today. The whole world is very excited. So only today, in our times, people know that you can go up to the space. But when we go up to the space, did you ever see water anyway? Where do you see water in space? Where did you see when you go above the heaven? There's a certain point that the sky is not blue anymore. From here, the sky is blue. When you go very, very high, it's all become black. Black, there's no more blue. In that black area, which is probably endless, if we go with a spaceship in a very, very fast speed, straight up, what would happen eventually? Let's say there's unlimited amount of energy. You go and go and go, and let's say you use the energy of the sun, You continue to travel and travel for days, for months. Where are you going to end? You're going to hit a wall in the end or what?
Out of where?
Out of the universe. Okay, so you're out of the space, out of the universe. For eternity, you travel and travel and travel. Would it ever stop? So I read once that really what it is, it's like a shape of an eight. Eight is a symbol of eternity. Shabbat, it's the seventh day of the creation. Why seventh? Because seventh symbolizes going out of material. Every material has six dimensions. Up and down, south, north, west, and east. Every material has six dimensions. Shabbat, it's going out of material into the spiritual dimension, into the spiritual world. A special spiritual, nothing was created on Shabbat. The Jew cannot create anything on Shabbat. Every one of us is a little God. We have a spark of God in ourselves. That's what we call the soul, the neshama, the divine soul that it blew into Adam Nastro, and later it split to thousands and millions of bodies. So what's going on here? So Shabbat is symbolized going out of material. What's eight, number eight, Brit Milah, circumcision on the eighth day? What's eight? Eight symbolizes eternity. Brit Netzach, this Brit, this covenant that we made with Hashem, it's an eternal covenant. So eight, if you go straight, if you have a highway that is in the shape of an eight, you drive and drive and drive and drive and drive forever and ever. You always go. It looks like you always go straight, but you never. You always go in the shape of an eight. That's what space is. But if a person walk now in a desert, let's say 100 kilometers, you walk in the middle of nowhere. Walk, 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 walk. What do you think? Where do you think you're gonna end in the end? Where?
You'll reach a city,
you'll
reach
the ocean. Huh? The desert have an edge, no? Eventually you get to water, to a city, something, no? Wrong. If the desert is big enough, you end in the same place where you've left. You will see, if they take a picture of you, a video of you from satellite, you would reach the same point where you left. If you stand in this feet, and you walk and walk for months, in the end, if you put the sign here, I'm leaving from here, I stick something here, a flag, and I walk and I walk and I walk, in the end, I'm going to come back to the same place. How can it be? That's a tricky question. No. The answer is, the right leg always walks a little bit stronger than the left, by an inch, half an inch. A little bit more. So you can never walk really straight. You always walk a little bit to the left, a little bit more, a little more, a little more. So you go and go and go. Eventually, you don't realize you're going in a circle. But that was a tricky question. But space, shape of an eight. So darkness. Okay, now comes the story of the snake. A lot of arguments about this snake. First, the first snake is called Nahash HaKadmoni, the ancient snake. There's that snake and all the other snakes that came later. That snake has a spiritual abilities. First, it was able to talk. We shouldn't be so surprised. We see parrots that talk. I know one parrot who made one Jew religious. You don't believe me? There's an organization in Israel called Arachim. You heard about it? Arachim, Israel? The head of Arachim is named Rabbi Yossi Valis. He's one of, perhaps started Arachim. He had a parrot that one time escaped home. And I think 5 years later, a person called him and he said, I have something to return to you. Why? The parrot made that secular Jew religious. Why? Every time Shabbat arrived, he used to scream, Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom. Why? Because when he comes from Shul Valis, he comes into his house, he screams, Shabbat Shalom. So the parrot, in his biological system, he knows every 7 days he screams, Shabbat Shalom. This Chiloni, he watched television, smoked cigarettes. This annoying parrot screamed to him, Shabbat Shalom. One day he started to think, listen, the animal knows better than me about Shabbat. Why this parrot started to investigate? In the end, they found out that this is the parrot of valleys. It's very interesting because Arachim is an organization that makes people balei tshuva. And the parrot of the president of Arachim escaped, and the parrot is like his master. It's like the donkey of Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair was refused to eat food that was maaser wasn't taking away from it. The animals sometimes recognize God better than us. Every animal that is attacked before the tiger or the cheetah slice their throat, what happened to those animals? Did you ever see? They picked up their head to the sky as their last option to Hashem, save me. This is a perek shira. All the animals is praising Hashem in their own languages. You get up in the morning, you come up to your terrace, you hear all the birds, the orchestra, the Miami Boys Choir, all the hundreds of parrots singing. What do you think they do? There's an orchestra. The animals praise Hashem, just like the Leviim in Bet HaMikdash. Yeah, the animal, the creation is much, much more sophisticated than people knows. Much more. So anyway, the snake was able to talk. After he seen, three curses was given to him. Three. First, you should know, snakes desire women. Even today, even after they were cursed, if a snake can attack a man or a woman, he usually will go for the woman, unless if he's from San Francisco. That's already a different story. Different story. Yeah, they made now a research in San Francisco. The animals over there are also influenced by the sins of the sinners there. It's not a joke. The animals are influenced by the behaving of the people around them. You should know that. So what happened? So the snake desired a woman. The Gemara say, in the old days, it wasn't like today. You have a house, gates, windows, the house is secure. In the old days, snakes come into your room while you sleep. What do you think happened? They come in. You live in a tent, you live in a cabin. So they crawl in, and some of them are dangerous. So what is this advice to women? When they sleep, they should put the legs of their bed in buckets of water. If the bed has four legs, put each leg inside a bucket full of water. Why? Because the snake smells the floor and they know who walked here. Just like the Arab Bedouin in Israel, some of them are in the Israeli army. If 5 hours ago someone broke into a place and killed or terrorism, the Israeli soldiers cannot smell the ground. But the Arab walks on his leg, on his feet, and he smells the ground. Much like the dogs have a great sense of smell. This gashashim, it's called gashashim. Gashash Bedoui means, since they live all their life in a desert, they have skills that people from the city don't have. They smell the ground, and they can tell you where the people went. It's amazing. Mamash, gashashim. So the snake smells the ground, and he knows where a person is. That's how they smell, where the person is. They follow the track. But when they come to water, they can't smell anymore. Once they reach water, from here on, they don't have smell, so they get stuck. The GPS say recalculating, but it got stuck on recalculating. No satellite connection. The snake doesn't know where to go now, so he doesn't know. If there's no bucket of water, he climbs on the leg of the bed, because, you know, he smells, and he goes up. So the Gemara say, if a snake runs after a woman, crawls after a woman, what she should do to get rid of him? If she's near a lake, she runs into the water. Once he gets to the water, he doesn't know how to track her. If there's no lake, she should take her top clothes and throw it to the side and run to the opposite side. And that will confuse him. You know, what is it like when you fly a jet airplanes, a war airplane, like F-15, F-16. So you know when the enemy shoot a missile at you, the missile is called infrared missile. Infrared means that it detects heat. It goes in air, and it follows, it's like a magnet. Magnet follow metal. This infrared follow heat. The missile has an eye. This eye is like a magnet, but after a source of heat. So it goes, how from hundreds of miles, it goes all the way like this and it hit the plane. You ever think? How does it know? To aim and to turn and to go diagonals and to change in the air. It goes after this. So if the plane goes, if the planes make a turn to the right, the missile also go like this. That's why they have to, rule number one, when you hear a warning that the radar say that something is following you, right away they break the stick all the way left or right to confuse the missile. But there's one more thing they do. They click on the missile, they have like a button, and they release flares. There is a box full of flares, very, very hot flares inside, and they have like a dynamite. Once the pilot hits, it releases flares. Fire goes down, and it confuses the missile. Instead of going after the engine of the other plane, it turns right after those flares, and that's how the plane gets saved. Same thing, that's how you confuse the snake. You throw your shirt or something, or your shoes, whatever, over there, and you run to the other side, they leave you alone. So this snake is in love with Chava. How can you not be in love with Chava? The Gemara said there are four most beautiful women ever lived. But Chava, it's like a territory of itself, because this is a creation of God himself. She wasn't born from a woman. This is a perfect creation of the hands of God. Couldn't be more perfect than that. So imagine today they have this woman, the prettiest in the world, that one, the prettiest in the world. They're all like monkeys compared to the beauty of Chava. So the snake desires her very much. So what does he try? He tries to get Adam killed, that he grabbed Chava from him to be with her. It sounds like a fairy tale, but this is really the secrets of the story here. And in the end, eventually he made the scene with her. And that scene put a spiritual poison in humankind that was dismissed by the Jewish nation in the time that they received the Torah and got repurified by God himself. Paska zohamatam, the Gemara says. Zohama means like a spiritual dirt. That spiritual dirt that was put in by this snake, which symbolized the Satan, the Yetzer Hara, was dismissed in a mountain of Sinai when the Jews received the Torah, when they heard the voice of God. Anyway, three curses Hashem gave the snake. One, that he had legs like a crocodile, he was able to stand, much like a person. What's the advantage of an animal that an animal can stand? What's so important? The difference between men and animals is that man is the only species in nature. There's 2 million different animals. And man is one of them, but man is different because he has a divine soul. All the animals don't have a soul. Man can stand. Man is the only one who can stand still, straight, and pick up his head like this without being bent down. Even chimpanzees, animals, they all bend down. Bears, they bend down. Even the ones who can stand on their leg, they walk on four. But even when they try to rise, they can never rise like a person can stand. Why? The important part of a person, which is his soul, is in his head. And the soul is the highest in a body of a person. Same thing in the face of a person. You have the mouth, you have the nose, and you have the eyes. It's three different levels of spirituality. The mouth is the lowest, the smell it's more spiritual, and the eyes is more spiritual. The eyes affect you in committing sins and mitzvot, the highest, the eyes. Then the smell. In Olam Haba, there's a heaven of smell. When the soul leaves the body on Motzei Shabbat and Saturday night, we smell special perfume. Why? Perfume revives the existing soul. There's an extra soul who enters the body in Shabbat. That soul lives to cheer up the soul that stays in the body. We smell something beautiful. And it relaxes the soul. The soul is suffering from saying goodbye to the extra soul. Also today, you know, today women buy perfumes. People think, perfumes, what the trillions of dollars business in the world. So much perfume, every bottle, $100, $80, $110, $200. Little bottle from perfumes, all kinds of perfumes. So many kinds of perfumes. Did you ever see how many kinds of perfumes you have? Every designer has hundreds of different names, different sizes, different shares. A whole massive industry and tons of fake perfumes, all kinds of things. What is the secret behind these perfumes? Why people care so much to smell good? What's the secret of this perfume, do you know? All attraction between men and women. there's some kind of an enzyme, I don't know how to call it, something in the brain of a person. Once he smells this perfume, his sexual attraction to this woman rises by hundreds of percent. Even if she wasn't his taste, wasn't interested in her. This is what makes these billions of dollars everyday business all over the world. That's really the secret in it. And this scientist who develops all these things, this is all based on this thing. I saw a few minutes documentary research on this, how it works, this industry of perfume. The smell, you have no idea how many smells we smell and how it's affect our choices in life and our spirituality and our holiness. Some righteous people in history, we have documents who testify that they came to certain places, they smelled the place, and they knew a big sin took place in this place yesterday, a few days ago. The actual feel, the actual spirituality of a place. The prophet said that when Mashiach comes, the Messiah will come, he will be able to smell the person and say how righteous he is and how not, by smell, by the sense of the smell. Bad, not kosher smells affecting the soul of a person. If it's bad smell, you cannot pray. You cannot mention the name of God. What do you care? Well, some baby made his bathroom next to me. What does it have to do with me? I want to unite with my God and pray and ask him for remedy. What do I care? There's the diapers next to me. The smell ruins the entire spirituality. No one can pray inside a bathroom. No one can say the name of Hashem. Even so, you see, the smell, it's something to do a lot with spirituality, for good and for bad. And the mouth, also, Torah or curses, food or not food. The mouth, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai begged Hashem to make a person, he said, why didn't you make a person two different mouths? One for Torah and learning and Tehillim, and one for everyday business. How the same mouth, 1 minute say, dear God, we love you, we praise you, appreciate you. 2 minutes later, you say to his wife, did you make me omelet? How many eggs you put? How can you talk about God and 2 minutes later about an omelet? Not to talk about cursing and dirty language. How can it be? That's what he couldn't believe. How can it be? The same tool he's been using for the most important thing in a creation and to the lowest thing in a creation by a second of a difference. So Hashem said to Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, one mouth a person cannot control. Imagine he had two. You know what would happen? Imagine a person has two mouths, here and here. They begin to argue. He walks in the street, the upper mouth say, hey, go right. Say the other one, be quiet. They begin to curse each other. You couldn't control yourself. You saw these Siamic twins that they two heads connected to the shoulders and they talk to each other? That's how it was. Imagine two people connect to one body. Two different brains, two souls, connect to one, sharing one body. One set of legs. The right one wants to go to the bathroom. The other one wants to do his homework. So now they have to compromise. What a horrible test in life. Hashem take two souls, lock them in one body. Probably two people were big enemies in past life. Always hit each other, fought against each other, all kinds of things, put them together, they must live in peace. One has to go to the bathroom, the other one has to sit and wait. One has to eat, the other one sit and wait. One wants to go here, they have to always make peace. It's very difficult. We cannot make one hour peace with our enemies. Imagine now 7 years be connected to the same body, you want to get married, the other one has to stand under the chuppah. You are sanctified to me. Kedat Moshe Israel. So the other one says, who, her or me? It's a good question. If a person has a boy like this with two heads, how many coins he has to give to the Kohen in Pidyon HaBen? Goes by the body or by the head? 5 or 10? Huh? This question was asked by... Somebody asked Rebbe this question in a Gemara. So Rebbe say, get out of Israel. Go to the exile, you chatzuf. You have the nerve to come make jokes at the rabbi. 5 minutes later, somebody came to him and said, Rabbi, my wife gave birth to a Siamic twins. How much I have to give to the Kohen? 5 or 10 coins? So Rebbe say, oh, Hashem warned me already to learn the halacha an hour before this guy came, and I thought he's joking. But it was warning from heaven. This question was asked also by King Solomon. So he says, spill hot boiling water on one and see if the other one scream I. What does it mean? They share the same nerve system. That's, by the way, one very hard question that I never got to understand. The answer of King Solomon looks like the opposite of the truth. Because if the other one scream I, doesn't mean it's one person. It's two different brains, two different souls. One can speak Hebrew, one can speak French at the same time. It's two different people. Two of them can choose different choices at the same second. One wants to move their legs to the right, the other one wants to move their legs to the left. It's like two captains fighting on the same wheel in a plane, or two drivers are pulling the wheel. But it's two different people. All right? If two heads are connected and they both speak different language, can you claim it's one individual? Based on what King Solomon says, if you spill the hot water on one, the other one scream high, that means it's one person. Because what happened is there was eight brothers, and the ninth one had two heads. So when the father died, the one with the two hands say, I need 20% of the wheel, not 10, I'm two people. And the other brother say, no, well, you're one person. It goes by the body. He said, no, we are two different people. Well, two different mouths, but he said, but it's one stomach. You eat the same amount of food. If you eat, the other one is full. Think about it, two mouths. One, Reuven eats, Shimon is full. Cannot say I'm hungry. It's a very complicated question. It sounds like a joke. I promise you, it's a brilliant issue. You can write a whole book about it. The sights to here and to there. You know, you're right. There's something called androgynous. It's not a man, it's not a woman, it's half and half. It has mutual parts. It's hard to know if it's a man or a woman. It's two things, androgynous and tum-tum. The Gemara speaks about it. One to a hundred million is born like that, but you have to know their law. What to do with a case like this? Is he a man? Is he a woman? Can he marry a woman? Can he marry a man? Can he give birth? If a person has a boy and an androgynous, you need a boy and a girl to make the first mitzvah in the Torah, pru urvu. It's in this parasha. Hashem said to Adam and Eve, multiply and have children. What does it mean according to the oral Torah? You need a boy and a girl that is worthy of giving birth. If they're barren, it doesn't count. A boy or a girl that you have that cannot give birth, they don't count. You only count one boy at least and one girl. The rest is extra. But you need one boy and one girl. You have 10 boys, it's not pruvu. 10 girls, it's not pruvu. 10 boys and girls, but they're all barren, God forbid, it's not pruvu. 10 boys and girls, you have them, and God forbid they died in a plane crash. You lost the mitzvah. At the moment that you died, you go up to the court of heaven. They check if you have a boy and a girl that is able to give birth and gave birth, then you count as you made this mitzvah. That's it. This mitzvah, it's a combination. It's a combination of a free will, if you want to get married and you do everything you can to get married. And the rest is not in your hand. Rashi had three daughters, didn't have boys. Was a very holy man, never had boys. Many other examples we can give. It's not 100% in your hand. You can be the most righteous person on earth. For whatever reason, you have only boys. You have only girls. The advantage in the old days was that a man can marry more than one woman. So if he try, and his wife is already 45 years old, and she doesn't give birth anymore. Today, they have all kinds of improvements, this, that, whatever. So, treatments. I'm talking 100 years ago. Your wife is already 45. That's it. The chance she gives birth is very, very low. You have 7 girls from her, or 6 boys. Now what you do, you marry a younger one, 30, 35, and then you're going to have at least one boy or two girls, and you have pruvu. Today, it's on a band. You cannot have more than one wife. So just for us to get the point is that in the old days it was easier to fulfill this mitzvah. And also people got married a lot younger. They had much more years. 12, 13, you're already married. By the time you stop giving birth, you have 30 years of attempts. 30 years, after 17, 20 kids, one of them will be at least a girl or a boy, no? So people had this route. Today, people with their corrupted lifestyle and lack of modesty and dirty heads and spoiled lifestyle and arrogance and desire for money and fame and fake and kinds of all kinds of material, by the time they want to get married, they already should be grandpas already. Why, Mr. X, why are you 40 years old and you're not married? I can't afford a house in Great Neck yet. What can I have my girl, she's waiting for me 7 years. I don't have the $2 million down payment that I need yet. By the time he will get the money, already, I don't want to tell you what's going to be. That's what happened today. Plus, let's say he wants to get married. He became Baal Tshuva and he understand. He make already so many sins in his life. Hashem said, I'm very sorry. Someone like you doesn't deserve. Better he stay single. All kinds of problems like this. But in the old days, this mitzvah had more luck. Today, many Jewish guys and girls and goyim don't have this mitzvah, don't give birth. Die single or have one or two kids, and that's it. Plus, some people don't care so much about this mitzvah. They're very stingy, and they don't have faith in God. They don't really trust God. So they say, already the day they get married, they say, we have maximum two kids. Nevertheless, they have five different dogs. But we maximum have two kids. So if the two will be boys, boys. Two will be girls, girls. They're not going to try for a third one. Why? It takes $1 million to raise a kid, Rabbi. You know, we calculate. Already calculate in 30 years how much money they're going to need. No emunah in Hashem. But if they trust Hashem, for sure they'll make this mitzvah provo, which has a big reward. Remember, it's the first mitzvah from 613. So the snake had three different curses. One, Hashem chopped his legs. Now he has to crawl. Second, he can eat whatever he wants. He won't feel different flavors. Everything will send like mud, will taste like mud. Sand. Whether he eats sand, whether he eats rats, doesn't matter. He may desire rats, he may desire cats, whatever, but he will. Oh, whatever he eats will always smell, will always taste like sand. So is that a curse or a blessing? Not necessarily a curse. Because how many of us wanted to have unlimited amount of parnasa? Every one of us worried that we won't have food and this and that. Imagine if you have a guarantee, you will always have bread. Unlimited, as much as you want. As much as you want. Bread, you will always have. You come to the bakery, you take whatever you want for free. The rest, you have to buy. Meat, fish, that, you have to buy. But bread, always. So at least you will, Baruch Hashem, we won't starve. We'll always have what to eat. We can survive on bread. So that's a relief. But who wants to eat bread all his life? Same taste all the time, you go crazy. So, yeah, it's a curse. What is it like a father who comes to his children and he say to one of them, you, I cannot stand you anymore. Here, take your share in my will. Take it in your life. Leave the house. I don't want to see your face ever again. Is that a gift or a punishment? Both. Punishment is that the father threw him out, doesn't want to have anything to do with him. What can be a bigger punishment than this? At the same time, he got his $100,000 in his life. Doesn't have to sit and retell him that his father will die young. He got it. He took his money. So, the snake, everything he eats tastes like sand. Hashem says, take your parnasa, take your food, leave me alone. I don't want anything to do with you. So he chopped his... The third one, hatred will remain between you and humankind forever. Think about it. What benefit the snake has that he always attacks people? What benefit? Just 2 weeks ago I heard that the worst snake in the world, the most poisonous snake in the world, that is poison from one time that he attacks, it's enough to kill 150 people. The amount of poison in one attack, 1 second, it's enough to kill 150 people. That's how little is his poison. And he beat a boy, 14, 15 years old, and the boy survived. When Hashem wants someone to survive, nothing can help. Some people try to commit suicide 20 times. Somehow they always survive. See, even to commit suicide, I don't know how I am. Shlomaisel. You know? So, what's happened with him? People and you will always be enemies. The snake attacks people. He doesn't eat the people. He doesn't eat us. He attacks the rat. We understand. He wants to eat. The cat, he wants to eat. I even saw a snake swallow a sheep. An old sheep. Think about it. You see him in his body. He's like elastic. It's stretched almost unlimited. A little snake stretch and stretch and stretch. Can swallow two people in one shot. But he doesn't eat people, really. So the Chazal say someone who speaks Lashon Hara is like a snake. Why? Because snake doesn't enjoy killing a person. Doesn't benefit anything from it. Same thing Lashon Hara. Oh, you heard about this Reuven, he got married. This guy, who would marry such a guy? What did you gain by that? You ruin his reputation. Nothing. You didn't make more money. Nobody will give you more respect. If any, people would look at you in a negative way if they know Torah. What did you gain by Lashon? Most of the Lashon Hara is for nothing. Just a habit to shoot. And this is one of the sins very difficult to correct, to fix. You stole 100, you come, you pay, and finish. You fixed it. You apologize, you regret, and end of story. The damage is clean. There is no control over it. Once you shoot, go and catch your bullet now. Let's see you. No way. And what did you gain by that? Nothing. Most of the Lashon Hara is nothing. And even if it's your competitor, you have a garage here and he has a garage here. Oh, don't go to him, he's a crook. And it looked like a $10,000 job just came to you because you spoke Lashon Hara about your competitor. That's what it looks like. Baloney. Whatever you're supposed to make, you make with other Lashon Hara. And whatever not supposed to be by you, you would lose anyway. So it's really just an illusion. It looks like it helps, but it doesn't really help. So you get nothing. Nobody ever gained from speaking Lashon Hara anything, like a snake. So now, this is very interesting. All three curses that Hashem cursed the snake, one of them is you. One. The one hatred between you and humankind, it says to him, only in this world. When Mashiach comes, this hatred will be gone. The nature will be corrected. We will be friends with the snakes. No more hatred, no more poison, no more attacking, none of this. Next thing, he crawl. The snake will go back to his perfect way as he was before. Why? The world will come to a perfect stage. But one curse remains even when Mashiach comes. What is it? V'nachash afar lachmo. That everything he eats will always taste like sand, like mud forever. In the prophet Isaiah, prophet Yeshayahu, he's speaking about days of Mashiach. A lion would live with a goat. All the opposites will all of a sudden become friends. The Gentiles and the Jews will be brothers. They go around, everyone would admire the Jews. Special days will be. Nobody has to worry. Money is like sand become like gold. Great life. He described all the opposites, how they became ideal, and how he ended this prophecy. V'nachash afar lachmo. And the snake still eats sand. Like everything he eats, like amazing. And in the parasha it says, Hashem gave him these three curses. What does he say to him? Kol yemechayecha. What's kol yemechayecha? If you know in the Haggadah of Pesach, we say, we have inside the Haggadah, in Passover night, we say kol yemechayecha. There's two opinions in the Gemara. Kol yemechayecha, olam hazeh, olam haba, right? One rabbi say it's the days and the nights. Yemechayecha, it's the days. Kol yemechayecha, to include the nights. Chazal say, the Chachamim, single against the majority of the Chachamim, they say no. Yamecha, it's this world. Kol yamechayecha lerabot yemot ha-Mashiach. To include days of Mashiach when the world will be a different world. So remember, yamechayecha, days of your life, is only this world before Mashiach comes. Kol the entire days of your life to include the days of Mashiach. From here we learn something very interesting. And the two curses Hashem said to him, Yemechayecha. Only in the sand he told him, Kol Yemechayecha. Va'afar tochal kol Yemechayecha. Even days of Mashiach. And 800 years later, when the prophet Isaiah came and gave his prophecy, it's perfectly matched. In the Torah, Kol Yemechayecha, to include days of Mashiach. When the prophet came, also he said, Ve'nachash afar lachmo. And that's how it's going to be. This will never change. Whatever reason, I don't know why. Just before time is running out, you know, Adam was supposed to live forever. After he made the sin, Hashem limited his life for 1,000 years. Then he saw that the only way to correct his sin will be when Mashiach comes. And he saw in his vision, he was a very holy man, he saw in his vision that the one who brings Mashiach will die and he will become a miscarriage. King David was supposed to die in his birth. He said, I might as well donate some of my life to him, to save him, because that's the only way to correct my sin. So he said to Hashem, how many years a person need to live, to make it, to correct the sin? Minimum, Yemesh notenu 70 shana. It says in Tehillim, Yemesh notenu baem 70 shana. In Tehillim it says, average life, 7 years. So he needs 7 years. He gave 7 years to King David, and he lived 930 years. That's how long he lived. Later he regret. When before he died, he started to think, why did I just give 7 years? He wanted it back. He said, it's a done deal already. King David got the 7 years. Adam was the one who made the Mizmor Shir Leyom HaShabbat. That's what we say. It's one of the writers in Tehillim, Adam. First Mizmor in a history. There were 10 songs from the creation was made until Mashiach would come. 10 songs. 9 of them already happened. One, it's going to be in the days of Mashiach. Which one? Shiru l'Adonai Shir Chadash. That's what we say every morning in a prayer. It's a part of Tehillim. It's a big prophecy. Shiru l'Adonai Shir Chadash. Shiru l'Adonai Kol Haaretz. This is going to be when Mashiach comes. Everyone would praise God in a beautiful choir. All the 9 songs, the Gemara say, each one was in his time. Moshe Rabbeinu, David HaMelech, Dvorah, Barak. All of the songs happen. All the songs in Hebrew you have like in Spanish. You have female language and male language. Who, he. Who, it's a man. He, it's a woman. Olech, it's a man walking. Olechet, it's a woman. It's male, female. All the song, Shir, right? Shiru LeHashem Shir Chadash. All the songs the Gemara says were all in the language of female. The one that is in the language of male is different. Why? It's unique from all the 10 songs. What is it? Bimot HaMashiach, it will be a different world. So this is the hint of Shiru LaHashem Shir Chadash. Sing to God a new song. So Adam made the first song from the 10th. What is it? Mizmor Shir Liyom HaShabbat. And what does it say? This is what it says. Ish Ba'ar Lo Yeda. Ba'ar means a fool. A fool will not know. Uchsil lo yavin et zot. Chsil, it's even bigger dumb. Total ignorant. Chsil, satum, blocked. Chsil lo yavin et zot. Will not understand. So a fool will not know. And a total ignorant will not understand. What? Bifroach reshaim kmo esev. Remember, there's no people when he wrote this song. It was the beginning of the creation. How many people were there? A few hundreds, maybe? A few thousand? Not even a million. We have 7 billion people today. He already told us a prophecy until the end of time. Bifroach reshaim kmo esev. The wicked people are pumping up everywhere like weeds. Everywhere you go, weeds, weeds, weeds. We don't need seeds for weeds. You don't need water for weeds. No matter where, in the desert, in Arizona, you go in the desert from LA to Arizona, you drive 5 hours. Besides the cactus, what do you see? Weeds everywhere. They grow with water, without water, on rocks, in your grass, in your driveway. You have cracks in your driveway, you come after a week, see weeds growing in the middle of your driveway. In the middle of the streets. I don't know how they always find where to grow. What's the secret here? Bifroach reshaim kmo esev. Vayatzitzu kol po'aleav. All the wicked people, you see them on everywhere you go like weeds. Wow, non-stop, non-stop. Vayatzitzu kol po'alei aven. The worst one are on top of the pyramid. They control the media, the world, this, the news. They have the money, they own the oil. Look what's happening in this world. It's Adam. Adam in the first big generation told us what's going to happen in this world. Vayatzitzu kol po'alei aven. Everyone who does bad, wicked act, is always the most famous one. What's the conclusion of all that? Vayatzitzu kol po'alei aven leishamdam ad. Moment before Hashem brings his big knife and chop all their heads off for eternity, they popping up. 70, 80 years, enjoy driving nice car, eating nice steaks, gossip all day, all night, playing golf, this, that, business, nice watches, no, big deal. After that, Leishamdam Adead. You know what does it mean, Leishamdam Adead? Who understands Hebrew here? Lashmid means to destroy. Don't leave a memory. You can kill a person, you still have a body. If your axe is crazy and he killed a cow, how much a cow cost? I don't know. $3,000, whatever it is. Now a dead cow, Muslim will not eat it. Who would eat it? Chinese, Christian, you know, in India they don't eat the cow even when it's alive. They don't slaughter it. They bow down to the cow. They drink the bathroom of the cow. They fight who's going to drink. Yeah. They put a bucket and they fight who's going to drink with cornflakes in the morning. You know? Yeah, you ever saw what happened when a cow crossed the street in India? The idols worshiper, they bow down to the cow. Wow. If the cow decides to stand, the cow is dreaming now in the middle of the highway in India. And nobody moves. Nobody honk. Nobody push. It's our God. Some goyim worship monkeys. They put a monkey on an altar and a big chair, and they all bow down to these monkeys. The monkeys make the bathroom over there. Yeah, you should see what kind of foolish people we have in our world. You think you read in the time of the Torah how people worship animals and idols? You think it's gone from the world? Everything the Torah have, you have today in the world. People who bow down to animals, people who worship animals, people who worship their bathroom, people who do all kinds of rats, temples in India, in Thailand, all kinds of things, idols, all kinds of statues. Everything still exists. Christians is idols worshippers, worshipping a man. Even in Judaism, you have idols worshippers, as I always say. They don't like to hear it. They're 100% idol worshipper. Don't believe me? I give you a website. You go, you see how they bow down to the Rebbe's chair. They put hidden camera. Hundreds of them stand and bow down to a chair of a dead man. What are they if not idols worshippers? 100%. They just don't like to hear it. And because they do nice things doesn't mean they're not idols worshippers. You know how many nice Christians there are in hospitals who come to visit people and bring clowns and guitar and give them mishloach manot even when it's not Purim? You know how many organizations like this? Yeah? Just because he's a nice Christian, Tommy or Paul, it makes him a non-idol worshipper. He still worship JC. God say he cannot stand idols worshipper. And he did not make conditions. Remember, some sins, you evaluate the person, good person, bad person, benefit society, doesn't benefit society, more wicked, more righteous. Over here, one act, finish. Don't want to hear about him. Death penalty. No, nowhere it says to the Beit Din, oh, he's an idol worshipper, but he does a lot of great things. He helps widows, he helps orphans, he puts tefillin on people, he makes holiday for all the homeless people. He comes visit the sick in hospital. He does a lot of things, all kinds of beautiful mitzvot. What does Hashem say? Execution with no mercy. One thing I cannot stand is idols worshippers. You can challenge me. Come, Kadima, go ahead. Where there's any permission to have a parole for the idols worshipper to replace their execution with a different punishment, with penalty, with anything? There's no tolerance in the Torah for idols worshipper. Shem said, come to them, don't have mercy on them. All the derogatory comments of the written Torah and the oral Torah, what we call the Talmud, against the Goyim, are only against the Goyim who worship idols. It's always used the word Akum. Akum means Oved Kochavim Umazalot. Akum, Ain, Chav, Vav, Mem. Ain, Oved, start, Oved, start with Ain. Kochavim, Kochav, stars, worshipping the stars. It's Chav, Kochav, Ain, Chav, Vav, it's Ve, and Mem, Mazalot, worshipping the horoscope, worshipping the galaxies, the stars, the trees, all these things. They don't speak about a goy who worship God and believes in one God and keep the seven law of Noah. These people have a share in heaven. The Torah can never speak bad against this kind of goyim. They're righteous goyim. They are much better than Jews who don't keep the Torah. They fulfill their mission in life. Whatever his name is, whether his name is Muhammad or Mustafa or John, doesn't matter. He followed the seven laws. He's a decent person. He believes in one God. He has a share to the world to come. Itzik, Avi, Moishi, drive on Shabbat, steal, worship idols, smoke cigarettes on Shabbat, do all kinds of things, don't have a share to the world to come. Torah is not racist. No discrimination. 100% logic, 100% according to the law. His father is the chief rabbi of Israel. He smokes on Shabbat. He has no share to the world to come. But his father is the most important person in the world. We don't care. Did you ever see that because your father is the most important rabbi in the world, the Sanhedrin won't execute you? We didn't see in the Tanakh many examples of a father is holy and the son is horrible. What was the end of Esav? His father was Isaac, Yitzchak, the holy father. What was happened with Esav? He chopped his head off, his head rolled on the floor. Imagine his head like a soccer ball. He kicked it into the goal and everyone screamed. That was the end of him. Why didn't help him? His father is Yitzchak. Ish bechetoy yumat. Where was JC? Why JC didn't save him? Because he born 1,300 years after him, that's why. You got the point here? Yitzchak didn't save Esav. Esav wasn't righteous. He paid the price. Nobody, none of us. So do you think you're going to come and say, hey, Hashem, you know, I'm sorry, you're right, I didn't listen to you. But remember who was my father? It's Rosh Yeshivat Lakewood. Rosh Yeshivat Ponov, who cares? Who cares? Vayitzer Hashem Elokim et Adam afar min Adamah. I brought you my new film, Bezrat Hashem, Life After Death. We worked very hard to make this film. Months of delay and all kinds of obstacles until finally it came through. We made one version in English, one in Hebrew. It's not available on the website to watch, or in the YouTube, or in the Facebook. Only available to order. Why? I want people to order, to take off their maaser money, the 10% that every Jew must give, and order CDs for cost price of $1 and give it to as many people as possible to save them. This is a 2-hour film. It proves with no doubt that the real life begins in a time of death. It shows all the scientific discoveries of the last 30 years of the parapsychologists, the cardiologists, and all the specialists who treat with death every day, everything they found. And it shows that everything, with no exception of what they spoke about, it's in the Torah and in the Kabbalah. What does it tell a normal human being? That we don't need all the research and investigations. And we have the Torah. The answers to everything is in our Torah. What's the answer? The Torah spoke about reincarnations. Torah spoke about life after death. The Talmud speaks about people who died and came back to life. All these things that they're discovering now, it's all in the Torah. That's very interesting. Why? Because when a person that doesn't believe in God, God forbid, or doesn't believe in the Torah, when he sees this film, I'm 100% convinced. You have to be a brainless if you still remain an atheist after you watch this film. So what's the goal of this film? Just to prove there's life after death? No. To show you that everything that we know today from scientific evidence, everything was already 3,300 years from the first moment we became a nation. And right next to it, it says you have to keep Shabbat. And you have to dress modest. And you have to eat kosher. You have to be righteous and straight and not a thief and many ends. That's the goal of this film. First, to prove that it's all divine. It's always come to the same foundation. First, to prove it's divine. Many times people tell me, what should I say to this person for this question? What should I say to that girl for that question? What's my answer? Don't waste your time. Every answer you give them, they'll come with another 50. All you have to do is to prove to them the Torah is divine, and in the end, tell them one sentence. There is a judgment in the end. Everyone has to pay. Whatever you did, good or bad, in the end, there's going to be a final bill. Nobody likes bill. You eat, you enjoy, steak, sushi, beautiful dessert, coffee. Ah, the guy come, play guitar for you, everything. What happened in the end? $60,000 bill. Yeah, in Manhattan, you have dinners, you, your wife, and your son. Didn't you hear the story, this Abramovitz? He went to Manhattan for a dinner, him, his girlfriend, and his son. Three people, $66,000 the bill was. Avrech in my yeshiva in Yerushalayim received $500 a month to live. And he had three children, seven children, each one with his different family. How much is that a year? 6,000 a year. How many years this dinner would cover a Jew who learns in yeshiva? And Abramovitz is a Jew. That's a goy, what does he know about Torah? I'm talking now a Jew. That dinner, let's say he would give up that 1 hour dinner. He would gain 1 trillion mitzvot for the lousy steak he ate in Manhattan. What do you think would happen to him when he come to his judgment day in front of Hashem? Kill himself. Hashem say, remember that dinner? How they brought you the bill in the end in a special leather book and everyone clapped for you. Wow, the famous Mr. Abramovitz. Let's see what would you get if you give up this dinner and take a Jew who sits and learns Torah. 50 years he support him with this dinner. How many years? Let's calculate. 6,000 years. 11 years. 11 years of Torah. Wow, it's billions of mitzvot. One lousy dinner. Multiply by 40 years of shchitut, the lifestyles that he probably has. Probably he can support all the yeshivot in the world by himself with the $30 billion that he has. A young guy. And you know how many Jews like this you have in the world? I already know more than 100, personally, by names. Probably thousands. Take these 100 billionaires. There's enough for all the ordinary Jews to learn Torah. These 1,000 billionaires can support everyone. But what are they busy with? Buying soccer teams in England. That's what they're busy with. That people take a piece of leather and kick it into the net, and 80,000 drunk people full of drugs and alcohol scream, yeah, we are the champion. And then this Jew come in front of Hashem, and all of us, with some exceptions, are jealous with him. Why am I not like him, a billionaire? And then in the end, he's the most miserable person on earth. How is he going to correct the damages that he made with the $30 billion that Hashem gave him? How will he start to correct it? You know what responsibility it is to have $30 billion when you can live with $10, $20 million your entire life like a king? $30 billion. You know what? How many people you can save? You can save a genocide. In the time of the Nazis, Yimach Shimo Adolf Eichmann offered the Zionist government of Israel a deal. The Nazis were collapsing. He say, I have 1 million Jews left. 5 million were gone, 1 million still left in ghettos. I'm willing to make a deal with you. I'll release all of them to Israel. That was before Israel became a state. The Zionist movement were very wealthy already, the Sochnut. Yoel Brand, a Zionist activist, went to meet with Eichmann. He told him, I need 10,000 trucks full of blankets and medicine. Every letter of credit that you show me, that you have, the first 1,000 trucks ready to be shipped, the money, I released 100,000 Jews. After I release them, you give me the trucks. Then I release another 100, you give me another. This was the deal. The Zionist government, including Ben-Gurion, the prime minister of Israel, made a vote. And Ben-Gurion say, we don't want these Jews, the immigrants. A lot of them are religious. They're not going to benefit us. We want to make a new communist country here. And they vote against it, and Eichmann killed the last million Jews. So what do we want from the Goyim? What do we want from the Goyim? The first government of Israel helped the Nazi kill a million Jews. So what do we want from the Arabs? What do we want from all the enemies of Israel? From Iran, whatever. What do we want from them? They are programmed to hate us. It's a part of the creation. Our own brothers. If you don't believe me, there's a film. We can go to Shofar, Rabbi Amnon Yitzchak. There's a film, Herzl and the Zionut, Herzl and the Zionism. They have English subtitles. Every Jew must watch it and get the shock of his life. How the Israeli communist anti-religion government helped the Nazis kill the last million Jews. And they had the money to save them. But they didn't want them because they want Israel to be a secular, goyish country. Liot am chofshi be'artzenu. This is what it says in the Israeli anthem. To be free nation in our land. No religion, no boss, nobody tells us what to do. And the religious people who arrived to Israel, what's the first thing they did? They stood by the planes and cut their peot. Don't believe? I'll show you videos of Ben-Gurion cutting the kids, the Yemenite kids. They arrived to Israel, he cuts their peot. They forced them to walk on Shabbat. They didn't have what to eat. They wouldn't work, they'll die. It was pikuach nefesh. Two generations later, all their grandchildren are the biggest criminals. The jails are full of them. Genocide! We did to ourselves, nobody makes a beep. The Goyim wants to destroy us. What are you surprised? It's a part of the creation. Everyone does his job in the world. Hashem wants us to be righteous. When we're not righteous, he says in the Torah, what happened? What happened? Mustafa and Ahmed and Arafat and Ahmadinejad, they come after you. You don't want to make peace with me. You're going to have to make peace with them. What are you surprised? It's a part of the Torah. But when our own brother, David, Yitzchak, Moshe, they helped the Nazis to put us in the gas chambers because they didn't want religion. That's what happened. All the grandchildren married Goyim. They all became Goyim. There's no memory from them. None of them left. Look at all the Israeli prime ministers. Look at the grandchildren where they are today, assimilated, intermarried. When they have their yortzeit, nobody comes to the grave even to say Kaddish for them, these people. Just one of them just died in Israel a month ago. He wrote in his will, no one is allowed to say Kaddish on me. That's how much they hate Hashem. A day before he goes to hell and they burn him for millions of years, the only thing can save him a little bit is the Kaddish. He makes sure to write in his will, no one is allowed to say Kaddish in my funeral. Everyone is upset. I was very happy. Baruch Hashem. Baruch Hashem, the fool, did what he has to do. Why? Let him pay for his crimes. Why not? You make crimes 80 years, now you want to get away with that? That's not fair. Why the righteous will have the same end like the wicked person just because his son will say Kaddish on him? What about the 80 years he destroyed millions of people with his articles in the newspaper for 40 years right against religion and against Hashem? So Hashem made him write his own destiny. This is like Titus. The Gemara said Titus who destroyed Bet HaMikdash. Unculus made a seance. He called JC, he called Bilam, he called Titus. He called their spirit in a seance. What Titus say? Every day they burn me, they take my ashes and spread it in 7 different rivers. Then they collect all the ashes, they make me back into a body, burn me again, that's my punishment. Why? That's what he wrote in his will. You know how many Israelis write in their wills to do the same thing? They don't know about Titus. They never read his Gemara. You know, you go to some houses in Israel, the fool come and say, want to see my father? Come, I'll show you my father. What do you mean your father? You're 70 years old. Here is my father in a little jar. The ashes. He puts it on a shelf in the living room on a plasma television. Father and his mother. The ashes. You understand what's happening here? Ignorance is very dangerous. It's not just a way of life. Okay, no. You don't know math. You don't know English. You don't know grammar. You don't know about cars. You don't know physics. No, big deal. You survive. Many ignorant made money. Many ignorant has what to eat. Many ignorant sleep well, control a lot of us. But when you don't know your destiny, your purpose of life, it's the biggest distraction. I want to make a last announcement. Time is up. In the next 2 weeks, I won't be here. I'm going away. I won't be here. So we're going into a long 3 weeks of off. Monday, another Monday, the following Monday, Bezrat Hashem. Please always, always check in my schedule. Sometimes there are changes, there are trips, and sometimes I'm not in town. So next 2 Mondays, there's no shiur, no lecture. Please look at my schedule in events. As always, I always update it. Always the time, if it's changing the time. So it's, we try always to update it in the website. The day of the lecture, you check before you leave your house. Thank you very much. Goodbye.